And this is why the gospel is still good news in the world today. Because God broke the law for love.
No, that's not quite accurate. God did not break the law. However, that does bring up an interesting question. What does it mean that Jesus Christ fulfilled the law or was an end to the law? So let's go to this passage. This passage in Matthew 5:17. He says, "I do not think," Jesus is saying, "that I came to abolish the law of the prophets. I did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill." So what does that mean? How exactly does Jesus fulfill the law? Well, before we look at that, let's go back a little bit further to, well, the law. In Leviticus 16, there's one aspect of the law. Now, this law that we're speaking about is the Old Testament law, the Mosaic law. And in this law, it is what's called a conditional covenant, meaning that you do this, then this happens. If then, if the people do this, then God will do that. If the people don't do this, well, then God will do that. And the law is first given in Exodus 19, or at least brought up. The people say that they will abide by it. God speaks to Moses. Moses comes back. And then I believe around Exodus 23, we see this law ratified or accepted by the people. They say that whatever God has said, we will do. Well, one very important aspect or component of the law is this atonement, this day of atonement that we see in Leviticus 16. Now, to get a good understanding, this is where we have this high priest who comes and makes atonement for the people. He intercedes for the people. And in that, there is a confession of the sins upon the head of this scapegoat to be sent away out of the view of or out of the camp of the people. And then we have this sacrificial atonement whereby an animal's blood is shed on the altar and accepted by God. The people will afflict themselves, afflict their souls, humble themselves, not eat, fast, not work. And then in faith, they accept what the Lord does, which is accept the offering. Well, there's something interesting that's stated in Leviticus 16. He says, "This shall be a permanent statute for you." The interesting thing is, though, we don't have this statute continuing. So what does this mean when God says this shall be a permanent statute? Look what he says, "For it is on this day that atonement shall be made for you to cleanse you from your sins. You will be cleansed from all your sins before the Lord." And that's interesting, before the Lord. So to be cleansed before the Lord. Not that you are actually cleansed, but how the Lord looks at you before him. He says, it is to be a Sabbath of solemn rest for you, that you may humble your souls. It is a permanent statute. So the priest who is anointed and ordained to serve as priest in his father's place shall make atonement. He shall put on the linen garments, the holy garments, and make atonement for the holy sanctuary. And he shall make atonement for the tent of the meeting. And for the altar, he shall also make atonement for the priests and for all the people in the assembly. That's a little bit different because we don't have this happening, but we're going to see how this is fulfilled in just a second. "Now, you shall have this as a permanent statute to do what and why? To make atonement for the sons of Israel for all their sins once every year. And just as the Lord has commanded Moses, he did." So the question is, how is this permanent? How is this going ongoing? We don't have this happening now. What is meant by that? Well, the permanency, the completion of this is going to be found in Jesus. And he speaks about this, though they may not be totally sure what he means by this in Leviticus 17. In Leviticus 17:11, he says, "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you on the altar to do what? To make atonement for your souls. It is by the blood, by reason of the life, that makes atonement." So this blood that's going to be given is going to make a payment. The Greek word that's used here, even in the Greek Septuagint for this word, is the word propitiation. This is to make a payment to satisfy a debt that's owed. And so how is it done? Well, the blood is given and it makes atonement. But notice something that's stated here. He says in the Hebrew, wa'ani natatin, which is I have given. Now, I have given is found in just this part that's highlighted here on the right. That word natatin is I have given. So in Hebrew, just like Greek, you don't have to have a separate pronoun before you have that verb. It's implied or embedded in the word. So we have this word natatin. However, right before it, we have the ani, which is I. So we have this statement that God is stating that I have given. What does that mean? He's saying that I myself have given. In other words, to kind of convey to them that I will be the one that will be supplying the blood for this atonement. Well, who is that? Well, that's none other than the person of Jesus Christ, which is why Hebrews 10:5 says, "Sacrifices and offerings," that is those blood of the bulls and goats, you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. Why? To be the sacrifice, to be the atonement. And in that way, when Jesus says, do not think that I came to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law, that is this completion of the law is fulfilled in what I'm going to do. Paul makes a statement in Romans 10:4. He says, for as Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes, so not just for Jews only, but for everyone. Remember, in Genesis 12, God tells Abram that through you, all of the families shall be blessed. So everyone, not just Israel, but also the people. This goes back to what he states in Genesis 3, where he tells the serpent, Adam and Eve are lined up, that the seed of this woman is going to bruise the head, or crush the head of the seed of the serpent, which is death. And so in this, we see what speaking, obviously we know now that this is speaking of Jesus, because Paul tells us in Galatians 3 that the seed is Christ. And so if we go to Galatians, we'll see that this law that is spoken of really in the same chapter, chapter 3 of Galatians, Paul ends up telling us what the purpose of the law is, which is to be a tutor, a guide to do what? To lead us to Christ, so that we might be justified by what? Faith. So we stand before the Lord, justified, why? By faith in his atoning work. So in that regard, God did not break the law. The law is fulfilled in Christ, complete. As a matter of fact, go back to this word here. It says, for Christ is the end of the law. Well, the word that's used here is the word telos, which does mean end, but it also means to be completed. And so he is the end of the law. He ends it in him. Everything that the law requires, that there be atonement so that we can stand before the Lord in right standing, Christ does just that. So therefore, how does Christ fulfill the law? By doing what the law demanded and providing the only way that we can be atoned for, which is his blood. Amen.